So late last week, I sent this message out. Quite in sync, but maybe that's not a huge issue. I'll fix that. I know that it's annoying, but what I'll do is fix that later, because if I tweak the audio settings now and get the, it's gonna be irritating. So you'll have to forgive me, and for most of the stream I'll just lag a little bit on video, but we'll just be down the bottom. Hopefully that'll be fine. It's partially also a problem with the fact that I'm using with stream and stuff. Okay, cool. Okay, so anyway, on the 16th of September, which is almost a week ago now, I sent out this tweet saying, hey, I'm gonna be able to stream. And someone, Luciano, said, why don't you review one of my crates? And I said, sure, I'll review one of your crates. And then I never did. So now I'm gonna do that. And let's see where we get to. So what I've been asked to review is Luciano's jwtinfo crate. A JWT stands for, I believe, JavaScript Web Token. If you'd like to follow through the code, I've just posted a link in the chat to it. And we'll start right from the beginning. I am going to clone the project. In fact, we might just do it through GitHub. No, I think I'll do it. I think I will do it right from the beginning. So just as someone else might be doing. And then I will, the way that we'll run this is I will clone the repository in GitHub. So there I am. And then I'm going to add some comments in the code and create that as a commit and push that up. And then Luciano can take whatever he wants from my suggestions. Probably most of it will be like ignore, won't fix, but some of it might be ciao or prego, you know, because Italians, they love saying ciao and prego. I know some other Italian as well, but not a lot. Okay, now I need to get the code. So to get the code, I open up a terminal and I'm going to go into my Scratch directory, which is kind of a space where I have lots of stuff. And I'm going to say git clone. And I did say jazz, didn't I? I'm jumping back to the music. And so I'm cloning my own branch, which means that I can push to it live. And then I'm not going to interfere with his work. Now, jwtinfo, what else do we need to do? Git checkout branch code review. Switch to new branch code review. Okay, cool. Right. Now I am going to, I wonder if this works. Yep, it works. So I'm going to use C-line because C-line has really good, a lot of people use VS Code. I've used VS Code a lot for coding in Rust. I have found, though, that it might be a me thing, but I found Rust Analyzer has crashed a lot. And so, or has, enter pro, am I going to do that? Okay, the first place I'm going to start is cargo.toml. So the cargo.toml file is a command line tool to get information about JWT tokens. So I sort of don't think that we need, okay, to start with, I'll just start commenting crazily. I don't know if we need these two. Maybe, I mean, it's pretty trivial stuff. These categories, I don't even know how heavily here they are. One thing that I would add is like just add GWT as a tag. And maybe add web, because people use JWTs a lot in web programming. Okay, so Luciani and Stefano are all good here. Our dependencies were tagged to specific versions of clap, which is for producing CL command line utilities. It stands for command line argument parser clap. I should get a clap just for remembering that. Okay, base 64 is pretty basic. We've got version 1.0 of Surde. Now, interestingly, and I think this is kind of a sensible option, it's what I do, they've excluded the patch release or the point release component of the version string, which means that it can automatically increment to the next one. And then we will have this library here, or sorry, this utility can maintain a lot of API stability. Pseudo.json just enables pseudo to understand JSON, and lazy static enables the kind of like global state. It enables things to be it enables variables to be added to. Let's just see where they've used it. So here's a macro, and the macro is normally used mod. Here we go. So we're creating this global variable base64 config at runtime, right at the start of the program, but we only want to do it once. So the question is like, what are we doing now? Okay, so where shall we start? Let's start in main. Okay, so we're reviewing code. Let's also bring up the request. So I'm just going to add this to put it always on top. And so what are the things that they want? We might like a review on project structure. Okay. So I, just as a initial feeling, for something as simple as this, I don't know if I would have created a like a mod directory just for a single module, because it kind of just adds bureaucracy where it's not required. And but that's just a completely opinionated view. So how about I, and that opinion is obviously something that people are free to disagree. They feel free absolutely to disagree with. And but just for a very simple project like this, the other thing that I would do, I'm just thinking about it now, is I think I like that testing is very close to the implementation. I wonder if we can change this. So if I run this test, although I think my code analyzer is still thinking, if I go tools and I go away from the presentation mode, it will make it smaller, but it will give me a little bit of extra information. I'm just going to increase the font size so that people can see a little bit about what's happening, and I'll do that once more. So what have we got? There should be a first thing. I just wonder whether or not a lot of this is repetition, so we're asserting, and I wonder if that can kind of be macrofied out. So but also that again is just a bit shit. What was it? I don't know. So this is, it's kind of a validation system, right? So I would like as well to know, so I'm just going to add some comments for myself. One thing to do would be to like fuzz the tester. Like we don't know what, and so and I'll consider quick test or hypothesis. It's a tool in the Python ecosystem. And there is actually a couple of fuzzing tools in Rust land, so allow me to look into those. So we've got bust fuzz. Actually, we don't. I want property testing. Yeah, so this was what I was thinking of originally. There are other versions, but what we want to avoid, I'm just thinking about these tests, is that I have these arbitrary strings, but they're not arbitrary strings, they're JWTs. We have these strings. Now, these are known inputs, but this library could potentially receive input of any kind. And what does it do if there's nothing? So a little bit confused as to why it's taking a long time to if I run this test. It's still compiling. So it's like it's Rust, it's still compiling. I'm just gonna quickly check the chat and see where we're at. If you're new to there we go. By the way, I should say hello to everybody. If you're new to streaming, you are more than welcome just to kind of lurk and listen. Alternatively, one of the advantages of being on stream or like what is that you get to ask questions live of the speaker. Oh, there's a to-do. Oh, right. So this isn't valid Rust code. You can see that I have I've spent too much of my life in another programming language. Let's try again. And so you are very, very welcome to ask me questions at any stage. And I will... Oh, okay, great. And I... our test is successful. That's useful because it means that if you haven't encountered JWTs before, what you get is this kind of encrypted string with three parts. And inside is kind of this packet of... Hello, I lost the first part. Oh, hi. I'm going to go with Loige? No. It's always difficult to know how to pronounce people's Twitch channels. But which first part? Oh, sorry. I assume that you mean that you came late. Don't worry, we've just started, so that's fine. You're absolutely fine. I'm just explaining what this crate does. So, what I'm doing in the stream. So, one of the things that I'm doing in the stream is doing some code review for Luciano, a good friend of mine who has bought my book and has been sort of collaborating with me informally for several years now. And has been a huge supporter of mine, and Luciano has asked me kindly to review one of his new crates, this thing called jwtinfo, which is a validator for JWTs. So he and a friend of his, I say a colleague probably, has Stefano, have got these test cases, and I'm thinking, well, what happens if we put in rubbish test text? So like, this is all valid, these are all, what happens if I just like, how about we just put in a silly byte, like some stupid Unicode thing. Now this will fail, so search parse token successfully. I want to test that. I wonder if I'm not having a lot of help from my RDE at the moment. It's not providing me any kind of sync, any kind of syntax helping. Normally, it'll offer to run my tests. Pass assert parse token successfully. I'm going to assert that I'm just going to give it a bad name, and that is, I'm going to assert that we can handle actually, it's not arbitrary, it's non-UTF-8. Now, I need a string that isn't arbitrary, that is not arbitrary, that is not UTF-8. So, what is a non-UTF-8 character? What is a non-UTF byte? Well, it's quite hard for me in an American keyword to enter a byte. So, let's find some other rubbish. Actually, I'm just going to see if I can... I'm going to try if I and that's some great bytes. Cool. I love it. Who needs it, UTF-8? So this will actually, I wonder if this will even compile, because there's some rubbish. So well, that's some useful rubbish actually. I'll run that test and it's gonna fail. Okay. It panicked. And so that's good. But it means that code review helped. Okay. So first we need base64. We'll just do base64, and there's another test which is similar but different. Which is non-UTF-8. Now, there are some libraries which can take and so we don't want, so consider not panicking. A panic, by the way, is a crash. It has a sort of a slightly technical meaning with inside computer systems, but whenever you see the term panic inside Rust code or inside the Rust ecosystem, what you're talking about is the program shutting down and crashing. Consider not panicking when encountering illegal input. Now, what happens if I put in a null byte? So we can do all these tests manually, but there are libraries like QuickCheck, for example, and there's a couple of others that are better, but I can't remember their names. I think QuickCheck is slightly old, on string. I'm going to say arbitrary vec u8, and I'll explain what this means shortly if you've never seen Rust, very, very quickly. So, in terms of this quick check thing, quick check will take a search space and try and find instances in which your tests will fail. Given, so there's an infinite number of strings that we could send to this library, and it will kind of try and search through that infinite space to find strings that fail. And it does it much more fast. It does it much more effectively than us just kind of randomly picking illegal inputs out. And now, where was I? Okay, so what the heck is a vec u8? Well, as you may have known if you've used Rust before, if you see a string, then you... that's what I wanted. So now I've got a null byte because I changed the prefix. Whereas R stands for raw, B stands for, you know, interpret this as a byte string. Now, Strings in Rust must be UTF-8 encoded. So if you are always parsing a string, that means that you have a problem. And over here we have some other problems because it is no longer legal Rust. But I'm just going to try and see what happens if I have a null and then a 9, which is, I think, another... another control character. Now, so what am I doing? Well, I got completely lost. So if I'm saying vec angle bracket uet close bracket, that means just arbitrary input. And the reason why this is, we've got vector, basically an extendable list, and uet stands for a single byte. Now, so this is an input of length 2, even though we've got 8 characters in there, because this represents the null byte, and this one represents the byte of 9. And the type is actually not vector uet, but if you've used Rust before, it'll make sense to you. It turns out that this is an array of length 2, which is close enough. I hope you'll forgive me. Right, so what else do we have? Oh, thanks for the follow. I'm gonna go with TSGT. TSGT green. I love it. If you want to ask me any questions at all, just throw a message in the chat, and I'll send you a tada. Right, there's a tada. I don't have many emojis set up in my channel. I'm a bit of a useless streamer from that point of view. So I'll just do this. TSGT. Probably someone has left. In fact, TSGT has left my chat after they gave me a follow, which is nice because I guess that means they're going to hang out with me later. But we'll carry on. Okay, so there's some other things. So that's testing, I think, or at least that's most of testing. What else did we want to provide some input on? Okay, I'm going to bring up the tweet. So this is the tweet from Luciano, who asked for help, project structure. Okay, so I've actually touched on that a little bit, I think, at the start, that I wouldn't have bothered to add, put JWT inside a module directory, because it's quite simple. Error management. We've talked about that. Oh, there he is. Hey. I say he, and I mean that like with a gender neutral he. I'll say they. Apologies. Now, can I mention you? Yes. There we go. So, great. Error management. I think what that means is not what are your errors about, but also how do you actually handle the error types within Rust. So we'll think about that. I'm going to focus specifically on this parse token. I'm really confused as to why my editor has decided that it's not going to provide any sort of assistance. I've paid for money for this thing, and it's not. Maybe it's just trying to be. Maybe I've disabled something. Normally, it comes up with type information and. What have I got? By the way, I need to move because my camera is actually in front of the screen, so I can't see it all. Okay, let's just focus on parse token. So parse token expects an ampersand str. What on earth is that? That's a string slice. Do you have Rust up running? Almost certainly. Let's check. Yeah, Rust up is going. Let's check plugin settings. Yeah, okay. Let's update Rust. I am confused, but I need to restart the ID, so hopefully... Actually, I won't wait. I'll just wait a little bit. I don't really care about TOML. I'll restart, and then hopefully... Unloading? What? Anyway. I hate it when you're trying to go quick and you can't. I have a suggestion, actually, just looking at that code. I've got another follower. Yay! Alex! Hey! Welcome! If you don't like being called out, I apologize. I should allow people just to lurk in peace, but I'm impressed. Or at least, it's fine. Plugins installed. Okay. Ah, power save mode is on. Disable power save mode. That was it, right? Okay. So now... 64 steps. I don't know if you can see this in the where you are. Okay, so the reason why I didn't have anything going was that, and I had this power save mode thing, which disables a lot of the functionality within the IDE because I was on battery with my laptop. So there we go. Where was I? Okay, so over here I had this parse token, and for some reason it's changed to that's this string. Now, okay, great. Here are my type hints. There's my color syntax hiding. Here we go. Okay, now I'm going to have a very small shout out to my book, not because I am asking you to buy it, but because I think there's actually a section in there that is very helpful for this particular problem that we've got, that what we want is to take an arbitrary input. And it might be from a string, it might be from a VEC8, it might be, we don't know where it's from. In this case, we know it's from a string, like a string slice, which is what's the type, this ampersand str thing, because it comes from a command line argument originally, but it might not forever, so we can actually use generics to improve it. And I think... So I'm just going to go into, I'm allowed to use my own book, funnily enough, and there was the section that I was looking for. Improving the ergonomics of functions that can only accept string or ampersand str. So one of the problems that you've got is... you only have a single type in parse token, but what we really want to do is allow people to put in anything. We want to accept arbitrary input. So one idea is to change this. Actually, I don't want to do that. Go into it. And I wonder if I can show you what I mean. I've lost that book page, so where did that go? That goes, we'll just add that to the top. Always on top. Okay, so what we want to do is have this as ref in here. It's a pretty scary annotation. So we've got T colon as ref str. So that means anything that can act as a string. And that will probably... You've got our type of text and type. So, and if we Actually, I won't bother with now that T is there. Now, the first thing that we need to do is token as ref. But now that doesn't feel like a large change. It actually, and this should actually, we should still be able to run all of our tests. Now clearly the two that we've added that fail will not run, but all of these other ones should be fine. And you'll notice, by the way, if you've been hanging out for a few minutes or a little bit of time, that we can now get a whole bunch of functionality out of the IDE that I didn't have before. Hey Jesse, by the way, welcome, thanks very much for the follow. It's really nice. I run Linux, so I don't have lots of fancy animations running. So yeah, by the way, so we've just made this tiny little change to the function declaration. So, and I should probably add this in my code review thing. So consider accepting any type that can, I've been coding in Python for a little bit, and so I'm using the wrong comment syntax, that can act as a stir, which is a string, but except it's not. Rust has this kind of difficult relationship with text types that that I talked about a lot in a very recent talk, and there are like about eight different types of types. There are eight kinds of types for dealing with various forms of strings in Rust, and don't use that as an excuse for not learning the language. It turns out that those distinctions are extremely important and are one of the reasons why Rust is able to guarantee safety, is because it can create an important distinction when you are dealing with, say, operating system paths, like file paths, versus just arbitrary string input. Now, this won't get us all the way to this as ref thing. Won't get us all the way to being able to accept like arbitrary bytes. I'm fairly certain that this will still refuse to work. Oh, this won't actually work because it won't be able to become a string. So the problem that we're trying to create is that actually, I'm not going to talk about my thing because that's actually not reviewing the original code. It's reviewing my own code. By the way, if you've just joined the stream, feel free to ask me any questions in the chat at all. I really enjoy answering them. It's one of the advantages of watching a coding live stream versus the like a YouTube tutorial. One of the things that I'm doing today is, and I'm just going to try and find the original tweet, is I'm trying to respond to Luciano's request for a code review, and we're recording he and his colleague Stefano have written a crate which provide like a command line utility which knows how to provide you some input, like provide some information out extracted from JWT. What I would really love, and I'm just thinking about this out loud, is like just a command line utility for creating JWTs. Like if I had just a, because I don't really understand the crypto stuff that goes in, and you know, I kind of see there's a signature and stuff in there, and I, you know, that's interesting. So what we need to do now, and what's highlighted here, is error management. Now, I haven't really provided any great I haven't provided a lot. So, let me think. So I wonder. Okay, so if you haven't encountered Rust, one of the things that you'll quickly learn, or maybe you will have to learn the hard way, is that every error type is its own, like, its own little thing. So what Luciano and Stefano have done is created kind of a wrapper type that wraps all of the errors from various crates that might blow up on them. So you've got this from the standard library, UTF-8 error, we've got decode error, we've got pseudo-JSON. And there is just some... and actually, this is a pattern that they probably... I know that Luciano owns Rust in Action, and this is a pattern that I recommend as one of the strategies for dealing with errors from multiple locations. And so... don't worry about this implementation right now. Maybe we should worry about it. Oh, would it be possible to zoom a bit on this IDE? Absolutely. Sorry about that. I will. I thought that was big enough, but obviously it's not. I will increase the font size. Sorry, by the way, if you ping me and I don't respond, it's because the comments are actually in a... I've got two windows, and there's a... Like, my laptop is just a little bit below my vision. So, actually, we'll get rid of this as well. Oh, yeah, it's kind of... It's not doing any harm. That noob! Hey! Welcome everybody. I really enjoy hanging out, so if you've got any questions, just ask me. Including like, what on earth are you doing, buddy? Here's the tweet that I'm responding to. I'm trying to provide some code review to Luciano's crate and talking about errors. So Luciano and Stefano, the two collaborators in this, have created an enum which wraps three different errors, plus it also provides its own bespoke error. So I would like maybe add pointers index to the beginning of the slice. So we've got a missing section. We could do something like U size, which would enable better error reporting, like more helpful error messages. So that may or may not sense if you've not seen Rust before. If you haven't, I apologize. Perhaps just ask it in the tweet, in the text chat, and I will flesh that out. Otherwise, I'll keep going. So what's this display thing? We've got our custom trait, our custom enum, but it needs to be able to be printed to the screen. And that's what format display can do. Format display comes out of the standard library. These are implementations for promoting these individual errors into the wrapper. So this kind of wraps them up. Now, what's happening here? Part error. I can see now why. I think the part error is used, like looking at how the error message is, it is it's trying to describe which section of the input is invalid. Now I'm going to suggest something slightly different from the way that has been suggested before, like has been used before. So I'm going to say, I'm interested in people's, so pay attention. if you've been watching, like, is this more ergonomic or not? So I've got a message thing, and I want to. So one of the things that I'm a little bit concerned about, one of the things that I'm concerned about is that we've got a lot of duplication in these lines. And so potentially, we'll be able to simplify a lot of this by format. What's happening here? I don't understand. Okay. I think actually this can just be like this. So we've got a message. And that format, by the way, returns a string. So you can see that we've got a type annotation now. That message is a string. And now we can use the write macro. We've got if here. And all we need to do is pass the string in. And that simplifies the code a little bit. So considering the commented out variation, I mean, it's just it has no functional difference at all. But there's the before and after. Actually, we can go one step better and just have a very local import. And we'll just. I can't remember multi-line string, like multi-line cursor. How do I add a cursor below? Oh, Luciana, is that you? Hi. So this is also Okay, cool. So this is just one suggestion for being able to improve the, like, again, there's no functional difference between what's above and below, but it just kind of simplifies, it makes it slightly easier to read, or at least I feel that way. So in just to confirm what's going on, unlike select, or like the select syntax that you might have seen from, say, any other language, match provides, like, match returns a value. And so each of these branches returns a string, and we can assign that to a variable, and then we can remove one element of duplication. So let's say, by the way, that we had this unexpected part. I was going to say we can do the similar thing up here. I will do that as well, just for fun. Make sure you allow raids. Who would raid me? I will. How do I do that? By the way, Nomad Pixel, I've got another follower. I love it. Hey. Welcome. I'm sorry for not noticing. That's kind of cool. I'm going to refer to Judd. Right. Okay. So I need to, I need to allow, maybe I need to get better at streaming, I think, is the obvious solution. Like, it's fun to do. I haven't been on stream for ages. So this is actually supposed to be like a test stream for me. Sorry. Just turned it to PG-13. Roles, followers, channel points. Sorry, I'm mucking around a little bit. I probably shouldn't change settings during a stream, but I should definitely look into how to do that. roles, channels, followings. I really want to turn something on. Imagine getting a raid. What even is a raid? I'm such a noob. Anyway, I'll carry on with what I'm doing. And then, okay. So, Jesse, you ask a super good question, which is over here on the left. And I'm going to bring it into the middle because there we go. Now, I don't know how to zoom in. Yeah. right. Okay. Now I'm getting the Twitch kind of thing. Like, you kind of hand off your followers. That can make a lot of sense. Like, we could do a raid at the end of this. Like, I've got about another hour on the clock. And if people would like to keep learning, hang out and rust, then you go do so. Anyway, right. So, where are we at? The question is, should things be in a separate directory? Now, my view is that for this particular project, there's no need for a separate directory. We could just have source. We could have a new file. And we could have jwt.rs. And like, do I want to add it to Git? No, I don't. Shush. Leave me alone. It's like, stop giving me feedback. I'm just trying to, like, we could just copy everything out of mod here and we would be good, I think. In fact, like, we could do that. That would be fine. Like, that would be absolutely fine. Like, but again, that's one of those areas in which it completely goes into people's gut feel. And if people feel like, you know, this thing could grow, then maybe it makes sense to have things very modularized. But right now, I think maybe it's not required. Okay, so I'm going to delete that file. Where am I at? I've still got, so I've talked a little bit about error management. It isn't, what? Oh, okay, so I've just confused the system because it thinks that this is actually a module. Yep. No, I don't want to do safe delete. I really just want you to delete. Okay. Now, I'm just going to re-implement this pattern of simplifying a lot of this, like, match code. I think it's a really nice thing to do, but also that is a really nice thing to do. I want to show you one other trick. You know, just here, what I don't like is repetition. I find repetition just a little bit, I don't even know how to explain it. I just don't like it. and I think that I can get it all on the same thing, but there's a slightly different. I'm just wondering about whether or not. Yeah, sorry. I keep forgetting to finish my sentence. What I am concerned about is that the format is different, and I want to be able to send the string back and its arguments into the next one, block. But I will just push forward and do this little local import with inside the function. This is something that you would kind of never see in Python land, but it's, I think, quite good inside the context of a match statement. But we've just been able to reduce the line width a little bit and just kind of remove some tokens. So now, can we return? What I really want to do is return the message and avoid the problem and just having multiple what gonna. Now, this is not gonna be. It's not gonna make sense to anything, and not right away, but I'm gonna try and do something tricky, which is to send the format string and its arguments back. I don't even know if this is useful. So I apologize if you're looking at this and you're kind of wanting to vomit. Now I don't know if it will work. So this now becomes, maybe this is a bit over-engineered. Like, it's perfectly fine as is. There's no reason maybe to do it this way. But it provides an alternative. And sometimes it's nice to explore the alternatives. So this one is now an empty string. Actually, that one goes there. And now the empty string is at the end. So you'll notice that we have pretty much eliminated all of the duplication. Right, okay. So in terms of, yeah, so Jesse, that you raise a really good point that, like, it's kind of frowned upon. Now, frowned upon is too strong because the module, I wouldn't say that using a mod directory, like a mod file, is kind of frowned upon. Well, maybe it is. I mean, I personally feel that you shouldn't be feel obligated to use all of the Rust 2018's, like, use all of the Rust 2018 idioms just because they're there. And that sounds controversial. It probably is. But I feel that if something is working for you and you understand it and it makes sense, then that's good. So this is just another way. By the way, if you hear my 4-year-old screaming at the moment, I apologize. This should. Oh, and there's the 2-year-old going. So I may need to bail quickly. Hopefully you'll forgive me. No one's complained yet, so I'll assume I'll just keep going, and neither has their mother, so who is also uh-oh. Okay, right, where else are we going? So what I really like about this code is that it has split out all of the different parts of and the reason why I think that's really good is it means that we can provide really informative error messages. Because often, I mean, I say this. Oh, by the way, this is great. Like, and in the config test and a, what is it? Is it an annotation? Or I'll just say it's an annotation. Annotation. Annotation is very useful. What I like is we've got parse token, which is then split into parse header, parse body, parse signature, and every single one of these could fail, and so we've got this question mark. So it's delegated through to here. Now the next, and that actually enables us to create these very, you know, useful error messages, header, body, signature. I would, if I could, somehow add this, the index of where the error hasn't been encountered. So I don't think I'll be able to do that right now. So I'm just actually going to add it in. I just add it again and consider adding, returning. Oh, I would say retaining the index of the string of the input of where the error was detected. Now, I'll just say what I mean by that. Line number and character number. That will provide the user with some more information about where they can fix things. Now, often JWTs are automatic. In fact, they're almost always automatically generated. So I don't expect that this will be used very often, because people often be using tooling that should be correct. But if I wanted to create my own JWT library to create them, then I would like to know where the error is that was being created. Okay. I'm looking. Parsing header, parsing body, parsing signature. And now if we... Oh, okay. So now we have some... I would add this. If I've got some more data, so what this is saying is, like, if you have an extra, if you have an extra component, JWTs are supposed to be three, so it's ABCD dot DEFG dot, I can't even remember, what's after J? G. Hi. We have three components. If we have a fourth, then there's a problem. It means that there's some kind of strange input. And the unexpected if I was to receive this, I would like to be shown where it is that I have got the problem. Now. Okay, great. So if you haven't seen Rust before, encountering okay sounds a bit strange. Okay maps is one component with a result. A result object is an enum, actually. It has a pass and a fail state. The pass state is actually okay, and the fail state is error. So we could, just in case you haven't ever encountered result, I'll just recreate it. And I'll just say, and we've got okay. And there's some generics in here too. So just okay T, error. So there's two type variables, and we have token there as one of them. I've just blown all of the type syntax up. So it's all confused because I've redefined result, but that's what a result is. If you haven't seen generic types, So if you're monitoring the chat, Luciana has just provided some really interesting background, which is that this example was created because they wanted to learn how to program in Rust, or put Rust into action, and I wanted to look inside it. And so interesting, yeah. And so it's interesting that I said that if I encountered something strange, I would like to see inside it. Right at the start of the stream, which you probably missed, we talked about, so I'm gonna actually move, I would say the error handling is mostly done. I think that's very, very clean. I like that it's decomposed. I do wonder I think that it's possible. So we mentioned panicking before, so that was in the tests, but I think that I've now dealt with error handling. There was some other, I've got 40 minutes left before I need to get back to it. When I say get back to it, probably I'm dropping my daughter off at school for she's starting school in 3 weeks' time, and so it's one of her school visits, and she, so she's going to visit the classroom today, which I quite am terrified about. Okay, so next one is enums. Now I'm in ModRS, and I'm just thinking about, I think that we're mostly done. I'm going to, okay, so I don't think most of the enums that we've created are these error enums. So I think that was where I spent most of the time talking about, which is fine. But I'll look at the other type definitions just for fun. So we don't make use of them very often. I would consider, if I could, I was going to say, we can add some other derives. So one thing we may wish to do is make them, is make these types comparable. I don't know if that's useful. Maybe it's not. Deserialize. Maybe it, you could extend it by implementing serialize. Oh no, we're just deserializing strings. We're not worried about generation. We're only worried about taking JWTs, which may be malformed, and kind of interrogating them and introspecting them. One thing that I find interesting is like type. So what a cultural difference with Rust programming versus say Python or JavaScript is that Rust can feel very bureaucratic. And whereas the other ones, you know, like dynamic languages are much more kind of free flowing. Now, one thing that we may wish to do, just going to put this in here, is I'm going to look up JWT header types and see in the standard as to whether or not there is, if they're defined. They probably are, in which case, by the way, I should say hello to anyone that's just joined me. Oh, and CK41N. I don't know what that, is that how you pronounce your nickname? Or is it CK? Is it like a leak code thing? Hi, welcome, thanks for the follow. It's awesome to have you. Okay, so what we want to look is, and find, is, you know, there's a, you know, we've got a whole section about how to encode. Actually, I may as well refer to the RFC. It's like, read me, you know, add a thing which is like, you know, and I'll just add a comment in here because it's markdown in this one. So this is the base of the crate. Consider compliance. With the RFC. So the RFC actually defines a method or an it blah, blah, JWC defines an algorithm for validating for a JWT, which is interesting because that, oh, and here is actually how to compare them. So maybe it is useful to be able to implement ord. Now, I really want to know about headers because it looks like there are different types. And we've got some claims and stuff. This is kind of insecure, validating implementation requirements, media types, overview. I don't care about... Oh, okay. So TYP is actually from... We've got these Jose headers, or at least I assume that's Jose headers. We've got Jose and JSON, which is kind of cute. Now, TYP encapsulated, so these are actually from the standard itself. So that's why they're... And this is the algorithm. So, I'm just trying to look at the RFC and see if whether or not there's a fixed type, a fixed number of valid inputs. Because if there is, you can make use of that to add further type safety to your input, your validation code, because we can provide exactly the problem. Sorry, we can provide exactly the problem. We can provide exact details about what the problem is if they are encountered. Now, there's a claims set. It just, one of the things, so we've got, right, yeah, sure. So type is almost always brackets JWT. I'm just going to say, JWT. Now, you don't need to do this. But, like, if you want to add further type system, so, like, further type safety to your code, you can parse, and then the next step is, like, you implement from str. And that, in fact, we could do that. Luciana, if you want me to, I can sort of show you what I mean by this. We'll do that. So instead of having string here, string could be anything, right? But what we want is to provide a very, very fast, we want to provide very fast feedback to the user about, like, what's wrong. That means we want to validate input. So, inside the str module, I know that people say string, but I always get confused. So if I go to the Rust documentation, standard array str, there's a trait in here from str which provides some which provides the ability for you to describe to Rust how string slices can become a concrete type. So I need to define an error, which at the moment I'm going to just say I'm just going to have a stupid one, which is like invalid input. Well, you should probably use one of the custom error types that you've got further down, and this will need to derive debug, and yep, that should be enough. Okay, so in partial equality, let's say. Okay. Now, from Stir. Now, unlike before, earlier in the stream, we talked about how we can accept anything that, like, we could use a generic type here. Right now, though, we don't want to do that. Match. JWT, let's say. And then type JWT, and let's just say, like, for whatever reason people use lowercase, we can validate that as correct. Fine, lower. I would prefer not to lower it because, like, I would not to normalize the string because we don't actually really want to allocate memory if we can avoid it, but whatever. If it's anything else, we're just going to say that it's type custom and then s to string. And I believe that this will... I'm not sure I'm following. Okay. Sorry about that. I will... I'll finish off what I'm trying to do. And then I'll explain, like, why it is that I'm doing so. Oh. Right, okay. So the question is... Well, actually, I raised... This is a good point. So... If it's anything else, let's just say we're, like, anything that's unexpected, we'll say that's an error. Now, this is a bit of a strange thing to... This could be okay. Now, why would you bother? Because somewhere along here, we will have an input string. So we're already testing for... Oh, yeah, right, of course. No, sorry. Yes, sorry, duh. We're already using, sorry, yes. Has already implemented last today. Sorry, made a big mistake in some sense. Well, yes, I made a big mistake. Because we're already using Surday, which is this string serialization system, we don't need to do it all manually. So I spent a long time explaining something which doesn't really need to be explained, so that's fantastic of me. I'll just leave it in because I spent so much work on it. I spent so much time putting the work in. By the way, just in case you were curious, this would enable some code like this, which would be like let header, and the would be type header, and from stir. Yeah, that's exactly right, Jesse. We can that's what it would enable. And you can see that, so we kind of get these magical parsing methods for free without needing to bring in a dependency, which is quite nice. So my favorite version of this is IP addresses. You can see, and of course it has to put me to shame. Oh, it's this thing. It's this line here. If we implement the right we implement the right trait, we can kind of convert raw strings into concrete types ourselves, and it becomes very, very ergonomic as someone who's using a library. Now, obviously, you, as the person who is writing a command line utility, you are the user of your own library, and so maybe you don't need this. Maybe it's too much, and so that's absolutely fine. Is it possible that I could change the color of the docs? Yeah, absolutely. I think that I can. I was actually a little bit concerned that it would be hard on people's eyes. Oh, sorry. The problem is, well, one of the problems is that using dark and light together is a bit confusing. Now, I say confusing, it hurts people's eyes, which is not useful. Okay, so where else have we, what else have we got to do? And again, I'm sorry for, and I should probably send this to dark mode as well. I've got exposing a library and CLI together. So this kind of comes to the next point is, do you make this available as a, oh! Kranzin K, hello. And Rixer, hi. It's wonderful to have you as followers. I'm really, really, feel free to hang out whenever you want. Yeah. 100%. Yeah, absolutely. I prefer dark too. I would go and muck around in my settings over here inside Twitter, but how about I stick to Rust? So the next point that I'm coming to is exposing a library and a CLI together. Now, I don't have a lot, but immediately I'll say I don't have a lot to say about this right now. the thing that you want to focus on as a person who's creating a library is trying to understand what it is that you... Have I seen Dark Reader? No. I tried one of those once, and it slowed my browser down completely. But I should definitely get onto that. I just totally derailed my thought though, so why did you talk to me? Okay, so if you haven't seen Rust, the question is, like, what is the library component of this and what is the internal component? And we can find any use of the functionality pub as public, and that becomes part of the library. Now, just to show off, and also to expose a little bit of ignorance perhaps, I want to build the docs for this crate. And I always get confused between whether or not it is cargo or rust up, but in this case it's actually cargo. So this is kind of like the Java doc version of for Rust or whatever alternative like language that you used, and but Rust version, like Rust implementation, is quite good. And so there are some things adding comments and usage examples. For public functions. Now, so inside, if I say build. Target, sorry, I think it's in target doc. There is a website. Now I'm just going to serve using a little command line utility. And now if I go to localhost, again, I apologize for the light. If I hunt for index, of course it's not actually going to work. Here's the source of, and the one that, what am I carrying? I'm jwtinfo, main rs.html. Here we go. Ooh, what's that? AU. I didn't know there was an AU. AU? Anyway, so you can see here that this is the actual source code. Now, if I were to use this crate as a library author, before you finish this, could you please comment and play with this? Yes, okay, I will. all I get is like the raw types. So there's some things past body. I wouldn't necessarily worry. Like, so I would just add some comments. Now, I'm surprised. I'm a little bit surprised that this is documented. Like these maybe my understanding of the documentation system is a bit, we can annotate things and tell Rust not to document internal functions, but in this case, like if we're thinking, like at the moment, this is kind of not that useful or not that interesting because this crate is not intended currently to be a library. So nothing is documented publicly. But as far as that question goes, like if I wanted to expose a library, what would I do to improve it? And this would definitely be adding documentation. The first thing that someone is going to do is they will look on docs.rs and they will see JWT in main and they won't really know what to do. This because this is literally what you get. You get main and then it returns a result. And then it's like, okay, what? Okay. Like, is that it? okay. Testing. We've talked a little bit about testing. I talked about that at the start. And that I would try to make sure that your, and I've tried to make sure that your utility is resilient to like malicious input. So by the way, here was git. I should have done these as individual commits, perhaps, but I'm just gonna git add. Where am I? Git add dot. Git commit. Oh, actually, I'll do it later. Do it later. I don't care about cargo lock. Git pod, I don't care about. Git ignore, I don't care about. Editor config is awesome, apparently. Now, code coverage, also useful. Oh! So that's actually in some tooling around there. I took notes, and I can rewatch the recording. Just want to make it easier to copy. One commit is more than fine. Okay, cool. By the way, if I am Luciano, I hope that nothing that I've said in this it comes across as me saying that the code is terrible or anything. It's perfect. I mean, it's exactly what you expect when you I think there's another way. Don't worry, like I write terrible code, and so I'm sure that if you sent me some of my stuff you'd be able to tear it to shreds. Now what else can we do? Build process, is there a build rs file? Oh, there's this install.sh. Okay, script, download and install the latest available release based on dep. I'm thinking. So one question to, I'm just going to add another one in the README, consider compliance with the RSC, and document, oh, why is that? It should be a comment. Which platforms, OS, CPU architecture. Supported. it probably will. So, like, it probably will save my eyes. I should smarten up. And document. Okay. Install it. Yeah, so we've got quite a few. I am surprised that we're using this. I guess it just is from Deep. Oh, wow! I got a sub! Oh my god! Ty! What the hell? Hey! Hey, Ty. Oh, my God. I got a subscriber. What the hell? That's crazy. By the way, it's off the charts. Boom. Oh, I'm stoked. I'm pumped. I'm totally stoked. Okay, great. Well, okay. Now I gotta think, like, what on earth was it doing? I want to check something else. Like, I've got cargo here, so can I just do cargo install blah? Dot. Oh, to install binaries you should compile the path. Yeah, I'm good. I'm real good. So Ty is a podcast. Podcast author is the wrong term. He's a podcaster. And I recently went on and on one of his interviews. And we chatted for like 2.5 hours nearly. It was a really fun chat. His podcast is called The Virtual World. And let me bring up the thread. Here we go. There's the episode, and it was a really, really fascinating discussion, because from two points of view, because I've had like a lot of people listen to it and be like, wow, thank you for being so honest and stuff. And I'm like, of course. I don't have a PR person. Like, I mean, I don't care about a lot of things that I think a lot of people, like, I'm still invisible enough to be able to speak freely. I don't think I'm invisible in the Rust community. Like, I've got a reasonable Twitter following and so forth, but I definitely believe that anyway. So hey Ty, that's great. Sorry, I'm just kind of like, I'm all over the show. Now, I've asked the term, this editor, to apply shell check to this shell script. Now, what the hell is shell script? Sorry, shell check to a shell. The thing is, like, luckily, so I'm talking to responding to Ty. So his question, his response was, oh, this isn't going to compile or anything because I've played it. I have, I've been mucking around. And so it's actually, I've broken the code. I've broken the build. I'll talk about Shelchuk and then respond to Ty's comment. So I think that, and you get to find that Shelchuk. So what on earth is Shelchuk? Shelchuk is a linter for shellcode. And what we get is a bunch of warnings that tell us to change some of our code. Now, that's useful. And now we're good. Now, it is over here, shellcheck.net, and it's a utility that you can download and install. It's free software. It's useful. And oh, by the way, hey Judd, did I not say hello and thanks for the follow? By the way, thanks for the follow. You're awesome. I was totally thrown with excitement from Ty's subscription. That anyway, let's go. So that's Shellcheck, and Shellcheck has said that actually this code is pretty good. It doesn't do some things that I like. I hate camel case. I really dislike it. I don't know why. I just really do. So whatever. I just want to throw up every time I see it, but whatever. I could never program in most languages, actually. Like, luckily Python and Rust have been fine for me. Yeah, so this kind of problem about you have an interview with someone and they're more than willing to talk about the easy stuff, and then they get these hard questions like, yeah, right, we'll go, yeah absolutely. You get hard questions like, you know, like, what's your view on this? And someone says, I can't talk about that. That sucks, because that immediately says that there's something to talk about that they're being restrictive, like they're being hidden about. And I know why people do it, because it's nervous to be controversial. Like, it's scary to be controversial. But also, it's important. I mean, if you're not willing to call things out, then you shouldn't be on the show. Like, you shouldn't be speaking publicly at all. Or at least, I say that from someone who doesn't have millions of dollars and millions of followers. I've got 4,000. Like, that's not zero. Anyway. Luciano, I have 10 minutes left on the stream. And are there any further questions that I haven't been able to answer while I've been spending last I'm just gonna, and if anyone else has got any questions, feel free to ask them. I would love to I would absolutely love them. I'd love to answer them. That's what I would, that was the sentence that I was trying to find. And now I just need to also bring in the chat again, because I've accidentally closed it. So if anyone does actually ask me any questions, I won't be able to answer them, which is, you know, obviously not useful. While we're kind of closing up and waiting for people to ask things, how about I give you a code, a discount code for the book? Would anyone be interested in that? No. If you go to rustinaction.com, you'll see I actually create my own thing of the book, because, and go to SL McNamara. It gives you a 42% discount on the book, which is pretty much as big as you get. And that's from here. By the way, if you don't want to pay for it, you don't strictly need to, because you can go to Livebook and read chapters for free. right now. Yeah, it's interesting, like the discounts thing, because on one side of it, it's really great because it means that people get to buy it cheaply. It also means that no one refuses, like no one is willing to buy full price. So like from like a royalties point of view, it definitely like definitely kind of like feels like a double-edged sword, or like find the right analogy. I'm not quite sure what it is, but absolutely. Manning definitely uses like a discount strategy, like to, and it definitely gets people over. It definitely gets people buying, but. Maybe what you mean by 70% is people should, like, maybe the ticket price should be higher so that when they get something discounted, then they're more likely to buy. Alternatively, why don't they just reduce the full price version? Like, if it is the case that no one wants to buy a technical book for more than $30, or then don't sell one for $30. Like, just sell them for 25. And like the other thing I think that sucks about buying technical books is shipping is really expensive, and I feel that because I live in New Zealand, and New Zealand is a long way away from the States, and we're about wrapping up, so I'm just gonna kind of keep chilling. Feel free to... Oh, I should also give people... If anyone wants to hang out on my Discord server, maybe that's a thing that I could share. It's probably going to be people who are like, no, I do not want to hang out on your Discord server. Luckily, actually, being like a baby streamer is kind of fun because you don't have... Yeah, that's right. That's totally true, Judd. Like, writing a book has been amazing from the point of view of my reputation and my standing within inside the Rust community, and it's provided me the opportunity to work for Canonical and travel overseas and give talks everywhere. It has not provided me the financial stability. I've sold just over, coming up to 8,000 copies, and I get about $2 US a book. So, this is 4 years of work, basically, most evenings. So it definitely feels, and 8,000 copies is a very good selling title. So there's the Discord server that will get you into the rules room, and feel free to click. Oh, hey Jesse, if that's you. Uh, 8,000 copies is insane, but 2,000 is like, what? Yeah. Yeah, I know. It's like, it sucks. It really sucks. So the way that the contracts are structured, especially for first authors, like if I was already famous, I'm sure that I would have got a better deal. But I had Judd's view that I'm not writing a book for the money. I'm writing a book for like the credentials, for the status. And so, I just kind of took whatever they gave, like whatever contract the publisher wanted to give me, and that was 10% of net royalties, which means that, or like 10% after costs. So if you are you're selling something online, you probably have like an affiliate fee and a credit card payment fee, so whatever's left after that, I get 10% of the remainder. Most people buy the title heavily discounted, which means that they're probably buying it for about $22 US, and then after fees and stuff, yeah, it comes out at about $2 a title for me in the hand. It's a little bit. So by the way, if you're confused, this is what we're talking about. I should say though that the book is selling really, really well. It just happens to be the case that like I don't make any money from it. So there we go. It's supposed to be $45, but I don't know anyone who buys it for $45. Ah, yeah. I would love to be a technical author, like a technical reviewer. Like, I think it'd be really fun. So, because you get to hang out with cool authors. Everyone loves technical authors, right? Anyway, I am going to wrap up. It's been really nice to hang out on stream. I wonder if I can send people to another stream. Actually, I'm just going to wrap up and allow you to kind of wander away. Feel free to click on look on the chat and find the Discord server. That's that you can hang out. My Twitter account is another place you can connect with me offline. And oh wow. And before I get involved in some really more fascinating, I need to execute raid. Who should I raid? I don't know. There are some Rust followers. I'm part of the team that I'm in. If I go to my own Twitch stream. Thanks, by the way, for teaching me how to stream. Like, I should go to streaming camp. They don't send people to streaming camp very often. And, where am I? I wonder if I... So, actually, I'm going to send you all to a friend of mine called Luis. Now, he's only got one person. And... No, I'm just mucking this up because... Luis von... He's only got one person watching his channel. So, there you go. So, go there. And hang out. I will see you all later. And... here is some more people, and it's absolutely my pleasure. It's been real fun to hang out, and I shall see you again, hopefully another time. I'm going to try and get on to a stream. I'm going to stream one or two times a week in this time of the day, probably on Fridays my time, which is Thursday in the US. So it'll be Thursday afternoons, evenings, and a couple of times in my evenings, which should be morning in Europe. And during the day in Asia. And I'll see you guys all later. Ciao.